Hey everyone, welcome to homeschool. So we are in the second video of the third chapter, that is the plant kingdom. So in the previous video we have completed various systems of classification as well as a general flow chart how exactly the plants are being classified. So there we had seen various classes. So among them, for the today's class we will pick up the algae. All right. So what are the general characteristics of algae we will first see, and then different classes of the algae we will study in detail. Okay, so general characteristics. So how exactly the algae reproduces, what are the cell wall made of algae made up of, or what exactly is the size and shape of the algae, that all we will see here now. So first very important point which you have to remember here about the algae is these are the organisms which usually are photosynthetic in nature because they have chlorophyll present in them. So the first character is they are photosynthetic. They are photosynthetic and they have chlorophyll. They are chlorophyll bearing organisms. Right? They are chlorophyll bearing organisms and they are photosynthetic in nature. And then, as I said in the previous video, these are thalloid structures. All right, these are thalloid or they are thallophytes. What is thallus or thallophytes? They are thalloids. Thalloids means there is no differentiation of root, stem and leaf. Okay, such organisms or such plants are called as thalloid plants of the algae. Fine. Then apart from that, these are autotrophic in nature. So since they are photosynthetic, it means that they can prepare their own food and they will be definitely autotrophs in nature. But still we will write them. They are autotrophic and majorly they are aquatic in nature. Okay, they are majorly aquatic. It means if algae has to grow, then there should be a proper amount of water content which is required for the growth of algae should be there. Okay, then few algae, okay, not all the algae, few algae, I will write it, few show symbiosis. Few of them show symbiosis. So one best example we had seen in the previous chapter, that was about the lichens. First example is lichen, which is an association of the algae and fungi. Isn't it? It was association of algae and fungi. So what is symbiosis? We have seen that also in the previous class. So symbiotic association is a mutual relationship wherein two different organisms stay together and both will not harm each other, but both will get benefited from each other. So here algae and fungi are two different organisms. Both are staying together. This algae cannot live without fungi and this fungi cannot live without this algae. So both are staying together, and what is happening here is algae is photosynthetic in nature. It is able to prepare its own food. So it is preparing the food and it is giving it to fungi. On the other side, fungi is providing shelter to the algae, as well as these fungi are filamentous in nature. We have seen it in the previous class, isn't it? They have hyphae-like structures. So what they do is they usually penetrate their hyphae deep into the soil and they absorb the moisture which is required for the algae for its growth. So here algae is benefited by fungi, fungi is also benefited by algae. So both are mutually benefited. So such a relationship is called as symbiotic association. Okay, and few algae show symbiosis. So one example wherein it is showing the symbiosis with the fungi. Another example where it is showing the symbiosis with an animal is, the second example is algae plus sloth bear. Algae and sloth bear are mutually benefited by each other, and they're staying together to show a symbiotic relationship. So what is the advantage here for each of the organism present together? So what are the mutual benefits here? So algae and sloth bear. See, algae, we know that they are phototrophic in nature and they want water for their survival. So firstly, we'll speak about the sloth bear. So sloth bear, actually it is made up of fur. It has fur all over it, and that fur usually absorbs water readily. Fine. So that fur of the sloth bear will be having more amount of water, and this algae which is actually growing on the sloth bear can easily get the proper amount of water from the sloth bear's fur. Okay, and in return, what is algae giving to it? In return, algae is actually giving the camouflage to the sloth bear so that sloth bear is escaping from the predators. I repeat it again, sloth bear has got fur all over the body. Okay, it has got fur all over the body, and that fur will absorb the water readily. So algae requires water for the survival. It requires lot of water. If there is no moisture, it cannot grow, isn't it? So since there is more amount of moisture in the fur of the sloth bear, the algae will absorb the water from the sloth bear. On the other side, the algae is giving camouflage to the sloth bear so that it escape the predators. Okay, it grows all over the sloth bear and it will not highlight the sloth bear so that it will escape from the predators. Okay, so that is a symbiotic relationship between the algae and sloth bear. Next, moving on to the various shapes or sizes of the algae. I'll write it here only. We will see the sizes of the algae. Size of the algae. So you can see the algae in a very, very smallest form to a very massive form, which is even like much more massiver than a human being. Okay, so the smallest or very colonial forms of algae are also being found. So we will write those. So algae can be seen in the colonial form also, and the example for the colonial form is the bollworm. In colonial form, example is bollworms. Next form is the filamentous form. Filamentous form, the example is Eulothrix. Filamentous form, example is Eulothrix. Okay. Next one, a very massive form of algae, that is massive form of algae, example is kelps. These kelps are marine forms, all right? So under the water in the oceans, usually we get to see very huge forms of algae, and those are called as kelps. So kelps are the example for massive algae. Filamentous algae, it is Eurothrix. Colonial algae, it is the all works. Okay, moving on to the reproduction. So reproduction, here again we can see different modes of reproduction. So firstly, it is the vegetative mode of reproduction. First one is vegetative reproduction. Vegetative reproduction is by fragmentation. It is by fragmentation. We have already discussed what is fragmentation many a times. Fragmentation is one full algal body. From the algal body, a small part will get separated or detached, and that detached part can grow up into a new organism. That is called as the fragmentation, which comes under the vegetative kind of reproduction. Then moving on to the asexual mode of reproduction. It is asexual mode of reproduction. So this is mainly by the formation of zoospores. Zoospores, we already have seen that these are the motile spores which have flagella on them. Zoospores, which are motile. So how are they motile? So they should definitely have a locomotory organ. Which is the locomotory organ? Locomotory organ is the flagella. Locomotory organ is the flagella here. Then moving on to the sexual reproduction. So sexual reproduction is by sexual mode of reproduction is mainly by the formation of the gametes. Formation of gametes. So there are different types of sexual reproduction based on how exactly the gametes look like or how the gametes are being formed. If the gametes, we know that there should be two gametes for the sexual reproduction. One should be a male gamete, another one should be a female gamete. If both the gametes are same, okay, if both the gametes are same, such type of sexual reproduction is called as isogamous mode. Here we will write them isogamous. Isogamous is both the gametes are same, that is similar gametes, fusion of similar gametes. Or we'll write it that way only. Fusion of similar gametes. Fusion of similar gametes. Then if both the gametes are different, okay, if both the gametes are different, that is called as the anisogamous. Anisogamous, wherein fusion of dissimilar, fusion of dissimilar gametes are called as anisogamous type of reproduction or anisogamy. Then another type of sexual reproduction is oogamous. Oogamous. See, here what happens, here two gametes which are involved here is, one is a large gamete which is non-motile in nature. Large gamete, and it is non-motile. Non-motile, and this large gamete which is non-motile is usually female. Okay, then another one is smaller gamete which is motile, and this is a male gamete. So the fusion of female gamete which is large and non-motile with the male gamete which is small and motile is called as the oogamous. So we have isogamous, anisogamous and oogamous modes of sexual reproduction based on the type of gametes which are participating in the fusion. So we will quote one example for each year. In case of the isogamous mode of reproduction, it is the spirogyra. For the isogamous, spirogyra is the example. For the anisogamous, Eudorina is the example. Eudorina, spirogyra. And then for the oogamous, it is again the olvox. Okay, it is the olvox. So isogamous, anisogamous and oogamous are the three modes or three types of the sexual reproduction. So these are few very general characteristics of the algae. So in detail characteristics, we will study in different classes of the algae, that is chlorophyce, phaeophyce and the rhodophyce. These are the classes of the algae which we will be studying in detail. Okay, but before going to the detailed study of the classes, we will also see what are the uses of the algae, very general or commercial uses of the algae first. First very important use of the algae is almost half of the carbon dioxide fixation on the earth is done by algae only. See, we already know that algae are photosynthetic in nature, so definitely they can fix the carbon dioxide. So half of the carbon dioxide fixation on earth is done by algae. Since it is fixing the carbon dioxide, then definitely on the other side it is also increasing the dissolved oxygen level in the environment. Okay, very very important use of the algae on the earth is half of the carbon dioxide fixation is done by algae in the form of photosynthesis, and hence it is increasing the dissolved oxygen level in the environment. Then second important use is a few algae are used as source of food. Few algae are used as source of food. Example for this is sargassum. Okay, that is the sargassum. Then another very very important use or commercially exploited one is agar. Agar is a nutrient source for the growth of various microorganisms, and this agar is obtained from one algae, a marine algae called as Gelidium. Agar is obtained from Gelidium. Agar is a nutrient source. It is a medium for the growth of the microorganisms. It means that here agar is acting as a food for the microorganisms growth. Okay, then one more very very important which is very widely used in the among the common people also is single cell protein. Chlorella is a algal form. Okay, chlorella is a algal form which is used as single cell protein. This is a very very popular dietary food which is consumed very widely actually. So it is quite proteinaceous in nature. So people who are lacking the proteins can actually have anyways in our country probably. It is in the use, but that doesn't have much awareness among all the common people. But in different countries, in the European countries and all, the single cell proteins are actually widely used. Fine. Then another important commercially exploited algae here is the brown algae and the red algae. We will see what is brown algae and red algae in detail in the next videos. So right now just remember, hydrocolloids like algin, hydrocolloids like algin and the carrageen are also being produced from the algae, and this algin is produced by brown algae and this carrageen is produced by the red algae. Okay, algin is produced by brown algae and carrageen is produced by the red algae. So these are some important uses of the algae here. Okay, so these are few general things which we were supposed to speak about the algae. So now next we will take up the different classes of algae. So among them we will take up first the chlorophyceae. Chlorophyceae, these are also called as green algae. So the reason why green algae they are called as is they have dominating pigments of chlorophyll A and B. We also know that plants are also green, and why they are green? Because they have chlorophyll in them. Similarly, these algae also have predominantly chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B. Since they have these two pigments, they usually look green in color, hence they are called as green algae. Okay, chlorophyceae, they are also called as green algae. And what are the characteristics here? The characteristics are they have chlorophyll A and B pigment. The predominant pigments present here are chlorophyll A and B. And these algae, they have very definite chloroplasts. They have definite chloroplasts. It means they have well developed chloroplasts. Okay, then these green algae or the members of chlorophyceae, they can be filamentous or colonial in form. If they are filamentous, or an example for the filamentous form of green algae is Spirogyra, and an example for the colonial form of green algae is Volvox. Okay, then speaking about the cell wall, here the cell wall of algae is made up of two different forms are there actually. That is, one inner layer and one outer layer is there, and both are made up of different materials. So the inner cell wall is made up of, or inner part of the cell wall is made up of cellulose. I'll write it as inner is cellulose and outer is pectose. The cell wall, it is actually of two layers. So the inner is cellulosic layer, outer one is pectoral layer. Okay, apart from this, there is one more important thing which you have to remember here is the presence of the storage bodies called as pyrenoids. Pyrenoids are the storage bodies. These are the storage bodies and these are present in the chloroplast. Storage bodies present in chloroplast. Okay, they are present in the chloroplast. And what does these pyrenoids contain? Actually, they should contain starch because they are photosynthetic in nature. So definitely glucose is being produced there and that is being later converted to starch. So they should store starch, but apart from the starch, these pyrenoids will also store proteins. Okay, they contain proteins along with starch. So how exactly it is present? Usually the aggregation of or the combination of protein and starch is present. So how that look like actually is, see, this is one structure which is present in the pyrenoid. Okay, it's a structure which is present in the pyrenoid and the central complex is the protein and this is starch. Okay, so these kind of structures are present in the pyrenoids. So pyrenoids are the storage bodies and usually it has to store the starch because they are photosynthetic in nature. As a result of photosynthesis, the glucose is produced. But apart from glucose, or which is converted into starch, along with the starch, the proteins are also stored in the pyrenoids. And few green algae have flagella. Few green algae have flagella. Some have flagella. Example for that is Chlamydomonas. Chlamydomonas is an example for flagellate green algae. Okay. Then about the reproduction. So reproduction is mainly by the vegetative mode. So if it is vegetative mode, it should be fragmentation. It should be fragmentation and we already know what is fragmentation, isn't it? And then moving on to the asexual mode of reproduction. See, the reproduction actually remains the same, that is vegetative, asexual and then the sexual mode of reproduction. But still we will see there, if there are any small changes, then we will definitely have a note of it. Okay. Asexual reproduction, this is mainly by the zoospores and the zoospores are flagellated spores. Asexual reproduction is mainly by zoospores which are flagellated. Okay, then moving on to the sexual mode of reproduction. In the sexual mode, here the haploid gametes will fuse. Here the haploid gametes will fuse. So we have also seen what are different types of the sexual reproduction based on the based on the type of the gametes. That is, it can be isogamous, it can be anisogamous, or it can be oogamous. Isogamous, if both the gametes are similar, then we call it as isogamous. If both the gametes are dissimilar, then it is called as anisogamous. In case of oogamous, here the female gamete is large and it is non-motile, whereas the male gamete is small and it is motile. So these two gametes will fuse to form the oogamous type of sexual reproduction. Okay, so chlorophyce, we will quickly revise the characteristics of chlorophyce. Chlorophyce, they are called as green algae. This is mainly due to the predominant pigments, that is chlorophyll A and chlorophyll B. And then there is a presence of a very definite chloroplast. And if the thing, they can be filamentous or they can be colonial. Example for the filamentous form is Spirogyra, and for the colonial form is Olvax. Then cell wall. The cell wall, there are again two layers here. The outer part of the cell wall has cellulose and the inner part has got the pectose. Then storage bodies. The storage bodies here are called as the pyrenoids, and apart from having the starch here, these pyrenoids also contain the proteins in them. As a rule, since the algae are photosynthetic in nature, they should definitely carry starch because they produce the glucose and that glucose is converted into starch here. So storage of starch is common, but apart from the starch, it is also storing the proteins there. Fine. And few of the green algae are flagellate. An example for that is the Chlamydomonas. Then moving on to the reproduction part. So it can happen through vegetative mode, asexual mode and sexual mode. So vegetative is fragmentation, that is a small part of the algal body will break down and that broken part will again grow into a new algal body. That is the vegetative reproduction or fragmentation. Then asexual reproduction, that is mainly by the formation of zoospores, and we know that zoospores are flagellated or motile spores. Then sexual mode of reproduction, here the haploid gametes will fuse, or the fusion of the gametes which are haploid in nature. And if the gametes which are fusing are similar, that we call it as isogamous. If the gametes which are fusing are dissimilar, then we call it as anisogamous. And the gametes which are fusing, among them the male is smaller and motile and the female is large and non-motile, such a fusion is called as oogamy or oogamous type of sexual reproduction. So this is about the chlorophyce. So among three classes of the algae, the first one is chlorophyce, second one is pheophyce, and third one is rhodophyce. So we have completed the first class, that is the chlorophyce. We will stop a video by this particular topic. So in the next video we will take up the rhodophyce and pheophyce. Okay, so subscribe the channel and like the videos as well as share the videos. Okay.